Good evening, Free Enterprise fans, RPG Limit Break fans, and fans and randomizers in general, and welcome to tonight's restream of Free Enterprise. We have a fantastic race here for you. Profcory versus Scratchdragon, both at 1-3, both fighting for their tournament lives. 3-3, if they can make it there, has an outside chance of getting in, so they definitely don't want to drop to that 4-loss threshold and effectively be out of this tournament. I'm ZoeVermilion, and I'm joined tonight by the wonderful voice of dijonketchup. How are you doing tonight, Dijon?
Well, I just got up from a nap about an hour ago, so I have no idea where I am. Time is meaningless, but other than that, I'm all right.
I mean, I woke up like 2 hours ago, so we're in the same boat there. But yeah, so looking here at the screen, we've got a Cid start. Cid is a very good character in the table flags. Very good early game physical attacker. For late game, he can be a huge HP sponge and be a chemist if you need him to be. And these objectives definitely aren't too bad. Definitely a potential for our restreamer to give our runners a bad time, but we could also be over pretty quickly, so I can go back to sleep.
Yeah, also, starting off here with a beefy raid from the Free Enterprise channel, so a race must have just ended over there. But yeah, these objectives are gonna be... Well, gonna have to find some keys, that's for sure.
Yep, we're looking for a Baron key, a Luka key, on top of our typical Legend Sword and Adamant. This fourth objective we can basically count as your free space on your bingo card. Just the boss of Mist Cave. That is the very first boss spot in the vanilla game. Unless you just run into a wyvern there and it somehow gets a turn before you, this is not something that's going to be any sort of issue for our runners. So yeah, we're looking for a couple of key items, looking for a Darkness Crystal or a pass for go mode, and then a way to get levels.
And of course, the runners are going to have to fight the instinct to instantly reset if it's not the Mist Dragon in Mist Cave.
Yeah, with both the Mist Cave and Waterfall checks, a lot of times you'll see runners just look in there, go, is Mist Dragon here? No? Okay, bye. And then if it's an objective, you see the shame, oh, wait, I have to do that, and they go back in. Fortunately, Mist Cave, it's like 4 squares of walking total to get from outside to the boss, so...
Yep. The good thing about the caves are that they mostly have an entrance and an exit. And in the vanilla game, that's the exit. And we can just go there whenever we want because we have a ship.
And we have a race that is underway. So time to see what our restreamer has in store today. Pointing at Cid.jpg and Kainazo coming from the throne himself and delivering a pass. Okay, so we may not see the moon today.
It depends entirely on where those keys and the sword and rock are.
Yep, no objectives that are required to be on the moon, so if we can find 2 other objectives outside of this Mist Cave somewhere on the blue planet, either above or underground, with that pass in hand, we can just go. Unless you need your Darkness Crystal for your grind, the 2 most optimal grinds in this flag set are locked by the Darkness Crystal, but maybe we see somebody do a door grind or a clapper grind, or even just go in with 1200 HP strats.
A mute dagger found immediately in that pot. And looks like an antlion is the first boss in Baron Inn.
Yep, and a DKC is sitting on the wrong side of the table. I like seeing him on the other side because that means that I am happy to have him out of the way. Scratchdragon going to Watery Pass, a typical opening move. Has some higher tier gear and a character check. We find a Iridia. I doubt we take Iridia right now, but it's good to have for later if you need a slingshot to get someone to nuke.
Looks like Iridia immediately.
Did he find like a sylph or something? Okay, anyway. We'll find out soon. Profcory.
Maybe just that confident.
Yeah. Profcory going to Mysidia, finding a punch mage and a white mage. A French vanilla Porum there.
I guess Corum and Hang.
Corum and Hang, yep.
The
Legend of Corum.
Merchandise.
Yep. I didn't see what was at Waterfall, but judging by Scratchdragon resetting out, I'm guessing it was not Demist.
Yeah, I didn't catch it either. Ralphie in chat says it was a door.
Ah, Evil Wall, that's a great place to see that, because you know that if you have to go a hook route, it's not going to be sitting for you there at King Queen Eblin. And an Ogre Axe for Scratchdragon. That's nice for that Sid.
Indeed. And Gaia Drum is a decent early game J item since, you know, Sid doesn't really have any AoE, and, you know, even if you find a Quake Kid, it's going to take a while for Quake Kid to get his Quake.
Yep, so looks like the characters from Mysidia decided to split up and go to Damseon and Ordeals, because we found a Porm here on Ordeals and a Yang in Damseon. So we're not finding much in the way of like power overwhelming right now. No Palums yet, no Canes, no Tella, which is kind of the prize you're looking for. One thing about that Ogre Axe though, it does give you the ability to equip a shield. And if you need to do a Mac Giant grind, having that additional defense power if you don't run across a Zeus Gauntlet is nice. Oh, and a Syrah.
Although, unfortunately, Syrah can't break through that in that cutscene, so...
Yeah.
Scratchdragon's gonna have to go around if he wants to check hops.
Nah, you can just walk back in and it clears.
Oh, I did not know this.
Yeah, anything that doesn't actually clear, you just leave and come back in and it's gone. I didn't realize that at first, because I got Shiva one time that just adds more ice, and I was like, what?
I learned something today. Also, that's a cursed ring.
That was a cursed ring. All right. Cursed ring, very important for agility manipulation. Which is a huge part of Free Enterprise. So nice to find one here. Another Cid, and that looked like it was either Baron Guards or Officer Soldier. So one of your free fights sitting here on Hobbs.
Not where you want to see a free fight.
Chat also pointing out there was a Soma drop in the back of Hobbs. Not super important right now, but if we come across a Tella, that could be pretty big.
Yeah, Tella notorious for his kind of low MP cap.
Yep, only has 90 MP. It does not increase with levels.
Ooh. Well, there's some incentive for Prof. Corey to find the Sand Ruby, because there's a Tella in the bed.
Yep, that is definitely not where you want to see your only Tella if it happens to be your only one, but at least you know there is one here. But the Soma drop allows Tella to go to 100 MP, because for story reasons, he's basically locked at 90 MP, so he doesn't cast Meteo. Because, spoilers, he casts it in the Tower of Zot and dies because he used more MP than he actually had. Giving him 100 MP allows him to cast Meteo, which can be like situationally useful, or gives him 4 weak casts.
I can't believe you would spoil this game for me.
It's only like... literally nearly 30 years old. It's fine. It's about as old as I am. It's okay.
Next you're gonna tell me what happens to Bruce Willis at the end of Sixth Sense.
I don't have the heart to do that to you. Anyway, Scratchdragon, this Antlion Cave, I believe I was talking about Soma drops. Yeah, this is a Dark Elf down here. Not a bad spot to find Dark Elf.
What does a pirate say when he loses all his coins through a hole in his pocket?
You're a little late, but yeah, it's me change.
Well, I didn't want to interrupt.
You're very courteous, unlike the pirate would have been. And that's a Moonveil.
It's a pretty good item to have.
It's a very good item if there ends up being a potentially annoying physical boss, like an Ogo Pogo at a pretty nasty location. We've already seen two of like the nastier physical bosses being Antlion and Evil Wall. But it dropped a little bit, but whoever's at that Leviathan spot, if it holds something important, could be really useful there.
players kind of trading places. Now profcory checking Dampsian and Scratchdragon going to Mysidia.
Yep, gonna kind of retrace each other's steps, get these character checks in place while we try and figure out exactly what we're gonna be doing for the rest of this seed. Surprised neither of them has peaked the Mist Cave with it being a required objective, but suppose it makes more sense if you are just more directly flying by it than either of these runners have been to peek in at that point rather than going out of your way for it.
Not entirely sure why Scratchdragon reset out of that cutscene, considering if he goes back to get someone from the Tower of Wishes, he's just going to have to run through it again.
Minimal time save. The running back out and having to do these shops, I feel like it's probably not a time save, but it also could be just a holdover from group flags where we didn't have the Tower of Wishes, so if you didn't see someone you wanted, you would just reset. And he's just gonna go do it again. Also, high five in Mysidia for our runners.
Prof Corey going double Sid.
Double Sid, grabbing a Porum here. Not deciding on the rest of the party just yet. This looks like we might be setting up for a Mac Giant grind in the future. Has a Poison Axe, has an Ogre Axe. Might ultimately decide not to take that Tella if he can find a Darkness Crystal and maybe a Zeus Gauntlet somewhere, or even just some decent heavy armor for Sid.
And yeah, Porum, a decent white mage of the two that are in the game. Generally, Rosa is preferable, but having not seen one so far, Prof Corey's kind of just hedging his bets and taking the Porum.
Yeah, and with two Sith in your party, getting access to earlier Berserk, Porum gets it at level 23 compared to Rosa at after level 23. I can't be bothered to memorize that number. It's going to be pretty useful, and without a Rosa in sight, yeah, might as well. Let's go ahead and grab it. I wouldn't be surprised if he maybe decides to take a second Rosa later, or like a second White Mage later, and do something like three physical fighters and two White Mages, because Bacchus Wines are not easily accessible in the table flag set. That would give him two sources of Berserk.
Yeah, and as Pepita in the chat says, Porum is in the top 10 White Mages of this game.
Now, you and I both know that our good friend Demarine would say that you can just drop that zero. I'm going to withhold my opinion so that I don't get bonked.
I mean, listen.
To you, gladly.
Wow.
Scratchdragon doing some shopping here while Prof Corey takes out this Dark Elf in the Antlion Cave. Scratchdragon did decide to take both Orm and the Yang, so he has four of his five members set. A couple physical fighters, a black mage that happens to know Asira, which is nice, and that white mage.
Yeah, this is a very different team comp than I'm used to seeing in this this stage of the tournament.
Yeah, we see Scratchdragon equipping a bow and arrow and then unequipping them from Sid, setting the back row bit, allowing him to hit for full damage while the back row and hit back rowed enemies for full damage regardless of where he's at. Because small programming oversight. Once you set that bit, no matter what you do, it doesn't go away. Oh, you were just talking about this. This is a vanilla alt gauntlet, or an alt vanilla gauntlet, if you would.
It's one of those fancy vanillas, like vanilla bean.
It's vanilla gelato.
Ooh.
So we're gonna get five scoops of vanilla here. It's a pretty big cone. Couldn't be a restream with me involved if there wasn't at least a little bit of vanilla, I suppose.
ZoeVermilion.
ZoeVermilion indeed.
Yes, Gambit, we had this exact alt vanilla last night.
That's what me and Dijon were talking about literally before the race started. Gelato's just milk and eggs.
Gelato, is it vegan?
I knew you wouldn't disappoint me there. Like, you can have gelato with nuts in it, but it needs to be like a nut flavored or nut filled gelato. Or if it's made in a facility that also processes nut products, you may want to be wary. I think we're getting off track here. What were we talking about? Why are we here?
Vanilla gauntlet. Not entirely sure. I didn't see what happened on Prof Corey's side to make him reset.
My best bet would be he had the Porm in the front row by accident and she got bopped, but we were talking about gelato and I don't know. So it's almost like they put us in this booth asking us to pay attention and not realizing that we were just going to meme the entire time.
It took like 200 something matches to put us together in the booth and one match to teach them that it's probably a bad idea.
The one and only time. Can you get summons from this gauntlet? So the answer to that is no, because the summon orbs have been replaced with the orbs that are used for stuff like Asura, Leviathan, Bahamut, etc. Because of the limited amount of items this game can hold, the Imp, Mage, and Cockatrice ones, all those were just effectively replaced with the higher tier summons that we put into the treasure. Prof Corey, using a bomb on bombs, I mean, it worked on two of them, but I don't know how effective this is going to be long term.
Yeah.
Not supposed to literally fight fire with fire.
I mean, it works on the gray ones. Kinda.
Yeah. Alright, and Scratchdragon is through. Finds a adamant rock. So, one part of the forge objective is down. We are now basically just looking for two out of three particular key items for Go Mode, either a Legend Sword, a Baron Key, or a Luka Key. Luka Key also comes with the annoying caveat. Well, actually, one in three have the annoying caveat of also needing underground access, so.
This is why you never fade Fabul. I have opinions on fading Fabul, and the opinion is don't.
My opinion is don't do it unless your name is Rivers McCown, but that's because I watched a lot of Fabul Gauntlet. Was that a siren that I just saw Prof Hori get, or?
I missed it. I was looking at Scratch Dragon's side.
Like, I swear I saw an S, and I don't know what else it could have been.
Was it one of those fancy S's that everyone knows how to draw, but no one knows where it came from?
I don't think so. I don't think the SNES has the graphical capacity to hold such power. Could have been a soft. Ah, thank you, Pepita. It was probably a soft. I got excited for no reason. Scratchdragon making his way up Mount Ordeals, finding the second form of the seed, says, no thank you. But will likely be continuing up. This play is kind of interesting. So you don't have a Tella. You know where one is if you're, I guess it was Prof Corey that saw it. You don't have a Cecil. You don't have Ordeals as an objective. So this is three bosses that have a chance of being demissed, but also have a chance of not. It's more likely than not. Oh, Yang pointing at Yang. And also only a single key item check. So this could be a huge time investment for absolutely no payoff.
Scala, that's too powerful.
Oh no. It took me a second to realize what she was talking about. Oh no.
Oh, I'm not gonna try and stop you. Why would I do that? I'm just saying, that's too powerful.
Anyway, back to the gameplay. At some point, Scratchdragon found a dancing dagger, which is on his Rydia. A very useful dagger that runners of the vanilla game will be very familiar with, because it is what carries you through the very early to mid game. A 300 to 400 damage magic attack used from using the dancing dagger. Very useful. Profcory finds Odin in the mist spot. Like to see Odin.
Just lightly taps him and he falls over.
Yep, that is another potentially nasty boss out of the pool. Still do not know where our underground nexus is coming from. We have two overworld checks remaining, and then a potential demist at Maga Sisters, which is what I'm always hoping for.
Demis could also... Oh, wait, no, never. Demis, stop saying Demis, could also be on Ordeals.
Yeah, could be. Could be here in the mirror room. But I'm really hoping for something like Demis at Maga Sisters, which leads to Earth Crystal, so you have to come back up. And then Zot leads to, say, Twin Harp. And Twin Harp leads to a hook. That's what I want.
Yeah, but if Ordeals leads to underground access, that could be a good gamble on Scratch Dragon's part to actually scale Mount Ordeals.
Yep, and the experience from these first two spots isn't bad either. We'll get your Forum, a few more useful spells. Profcory... I didn't see who the second Boston Baroness was. It looks like maybe he had some issues there.
It was CPU.
Oh, CPU. Okay. Yeah. So it looks like he was back growing his second Sid so that he could hit CPU at full strength, because CPU is a back road enemy. This is actually a really fantastic spot for CPU. This spot is fairly slow. It is very punchy, but CPU doesn't punch.
Punch, it's all in the mind.
And with the HP spread amongst the three units, this is a really, really good spot to seize.
Oh, magma key.
All right, Scratch Dragon makes the play to Ordeals and goes and proves me wrong and finds some dark imps in the mirror for his trouble.
Yeah, easy slot and easy boss in that slot, so.
Yep.
And profcory is through that CPU.
Yep. For those that are joining in, because we are in the RPG Limit Break channel, who may have not seen this before, this is Final Fantasy IV Free Enterprise, an open world randomizer for Final Fantasy IV, aka Final Fantasy II US. It's a fantastic game, fantastic randomizer, and this is a fantastic tournament that we're in the middle of. But that was music.
Yeah, we've got music sign.
Now, is profcory going to be the hero of the people and chase that music early? He's got two really good physical fighters, which is what you want for Cave Magnes, because the MDef there is just through the roof. But it might pull him away from this Ordeals where the magma key is.
Yep, all Tellas learn media wherever they are, and we know that Tella is in the bed at Kaipo.
In the Kaipo bed. There could be others floating around, but that is definitely one that we know of. Profcory making the right play here. Going to do Ordeals. We'll go through three bosses that shouldn't take too terribly long. That Luge is It's pretty nice to see at the back attack slot because you're already going to have to basically sit through that cutscene tech, so might as well get out of the way early. But we'll get his magma key while Scratchdragon drops his down the aggro well. I love how over the top this sound effect is and the explosion is. I know you're destroying like an entire mountain range, but it just still feels over the top.
It's fun that you can just drop a key down a well and it causes that.
Yeah, I don't understand it. I don't understand why that happens.
I don't know the lore.
It's literally, hey, like you get it in the vanilla game and it's like, hey, take this to Aggert. And you're like, okay, cool. And you drop it down the well and it does it. And you're like, all right, cool. Let's go.
Well, that's gone.
Yeah. That is my favorite. One of my favorite things in this randomizer is if you have a hook seed and, you know, you have to drop the magma key down later, or even if you just want to go be a cool Easter egg, drop the magma key down once this hole is already open from coming up after doing a hook route. And a little text box will come up and just go, well, that's gone. So satisfying.
Yeah, it's fun when that's an objective and the underground access is hook.
D-Stoop asking, is profcory stuck with both SIDs? We do have permajoin on in this particular flag set for this stage of the tournament. So he is going to be going through the endgame with these two SIDs in form, though I would not say he is stuck with them. Sid is a fantastic character at this stage of the tournament.
Scala dropping some spicy lore on us. If you talk to the folks in Aggert, you learn that they're descendants of the dwarves.
I imagine they don't say that in Free Enterprise, though, because like nearly every NPC has had their dialogue changed. My favorite being the guy, the poor soldier in Eblin Cave who says hook seeds are the worst. Oh, hey, look, there's Tella in a box.
Of course, Scratch Dragon did not peek the bed. That was only profcory.
Yep. But he still has that one slot in his party, so I imagine he will probably go check it and be pretty happy that he's already done ordeals. He'll still need a darkness crystal, though. I personally, as both a viewer and a restreamer of Garbage Fires, hopes that the darkness crystal is hidden behind something that neither of these runners want to do, but they get their go mode elsewhere and have to get creative with their grind. That's what I'm really hoping for today.
Just a nasty boss in the Fame Arch. Which, speaking of, we're about to see what the Fame Arch bosses are.
All right, who is the power couple today? It is some variant of Leg and Octomammoth. Now, whether that is was it Leviathan, let me show you how, or Quarterleg being the element spot, we will not know because Scratch Dragon did not pick it. So they're either a power polycule or just a power couple. So I will say, if it is elements, Octomammoth has 8 tentacles, that is 2 each, so they can hug each of the elements at the same time.
Aw.
Bet you weren't expecting wholesome. I can do wholesome. Anyway.
So much of Final Fantasy IV's plot could have been avoided if Cecil, Kane, and Rosa were polyamorous.
Right, yeah, no, everything would have been fine. Scratch Dragon going down. Yang's going to talk to himself in the bed. This turns on Sheila 1 and allows us to get that key item when we go back up to Fabul. Kind of the tenets of this tournament have been, do your required objectives, check your freebies. So Scratch Dragon making good on that second one. Gonna check Kaipo. Gonna find this Tella.
Gonna be happy about it.
was like, wait, no, oh, no, yeah, I want that.
It's like what I was saying earlier about the reflex to reset out of Mist Cave.
Yeah, that was the white-haired character that I do want in my party, as opposed to maybe an Edward or a Rosa, which I don't think you would take for your fifth slot here. So.
Yeah, not when you've already got a Porum.
Yeah, Porum in a party full otherwise. This shop, I assume profcory checked this earlier, but I missed it, has silk webs and star veils. So a very good shop for J items. Silk webs cast slow on your enemies, useful on a variety of bosses in different spots, most notably Threemus. And then star veils put up a wall on your character, and very useful for Threemus, as well as stuff like Wyvern, Bahamut, Golbez. Useful on Asura too, but you have to use two.
It's a one-stop shop for Threemus. Just silk web and star veils, and that's all you need.
If you're experienced at playing Free Enterprise and you ever want to give yourself a big challenge, go play with no J items in shops, and come back to me and let me know how that goes.
Why would you do that to yourself?
Because it completely turns the game upside down, as it's way more impactful than you would think. Prof Corey found a Bacchus wine down here. That's pretty useful.
Prof Corey also did not turn the flashing lights off.
Yeah, that's a runner preference. I always have mine off, but it is something that we do not dictate. Also, there was a question in chat that a ticket obtained this character objectives are not generated with this flag set because of permanent characters. You're right, they're not being generated. We have only quests being generated. But even if you have permajoin on and you have a full party, if you find your character for your objective, you still clear the objective, even if you can't take them. The objective is just to basically find the character and be given the opportunity, like get the Cecil join text. Not necessarily actually adding them to your party.
Prof Corey bought a Soma drop, probably because he has that sand ruby and now knows that he's got a Tella waiting for him.
Yep. Like, Scratchdragon went there on the gamble. Prof Corey already knows. Show us. Still don't know if it's leg or not. Okay.
He was thinking about it for a second.
Another question, are these flags through the rest of the tournament, or will they change? These flags will be through the end of the tournament. We had a different flag set for the group stages and the like Swiss rounds, but for our table here and the brackets, all the way through the finals, this will be the flag set.
Also, Sheila won, got the goods. That was a Baron key.
All right, so that will give us access to objective number two, and if we find a Luka key in this Baron castle or a legend sword, that'll be go mode without a darkness crystal, and I'd be real curious to see what happens there. All right, Prof Corey gonna go talk to Yang in the bed, allow him access to that Sheila One check to get his Baron key. Meanwhile, Scratchdragon heading over to Baron Inn has not yet done this check, so has not found the Twin Harp. Will be doing so shortly. So, while it does seem that Scratchdragon may have a small lead here, there's a few outside checks that each runner hasn't done that make this a pretty even race thus far. Chat asking where to grind if there is no darkness crystal. Sirens and Cocoa Shop are possible but rare if they end up forging. They can do trapdoors in Luca if they end up getting the Luca for that objective three. There's also Clapper and Arachne Grinds. Arachne Grinds require you to get your Forum to float or have this Tella with float. Clapper Grinds do not. They're a little annoying. But I would love to see someone bust out one of those grinds in the table tournament or table stage.
Yeah, it's not one that I've seen.
I've done an Arachne grind in the vanilla game just to get levels to be able to get through Asira and Leviathan, but never in for Enterprise.
Also, if you're just feeling... Well, actually, I was going to say, if you're feeling bold, you could just go with random encounters, but I honestly don't know what a spot would be that people would want to do that.
So that would be, if you do it in the Feymarch, that's where you can find the summoners that summon the Arachnes. Which, Arachnes only cast Quake, so if you have this float on your Tella, full cast it on your party, and the Arachne is not going to be any threat to you. And they do give a decent chunk of experience being a Feymarch enemy.
So, Fluffy Mittens saying, take edge to the... Oh, never mind. He was talking about vanilla. They were talking about vanilla.
Yep.
So I was pointing out that, edge cannot steal sirens in this flag set.
Yes, Barabas, you can, up until the point where you, I think, enter the sealed cave, somewhere around there, maybe it's Get the Darkness Crystal, you can re-enter the Tower of Babel. And Baron Key Get for profcory, Twin Harp Get for Scratchdragon. Shoutouts to Maggie, the cat behind the scenes, doing the tracking, having to light up those two items simultaneously.
And now we're 1-1 on key items.
Yeah, our runners are basically dead even right now. Having the exact same key item loadout, the exact same objective complete. Their parties basically both complete. Did profcory grab the Tella while I was talking about Arachnes?
I did not see it happen.
Nope, it hasn't happened yet. Oh, he did. No, he did. He just doesn't have his fifth character, so.
Oh, okay.
Still needs one more character, but not wasting any time. Gonna check this Baron weapon shop. These two chests back here can hold some decent stuff. Another
Soma drop.
Not the worst. there's your Mac Giant shop right there. Like, that is, Ogre X, Poison X, Charm Arrows, Lit Arrows. I think that was a Blitz Whip. All of that will hit Mac Giants. That's kind of incredible. Scratch Dragon foregoing the shop and diving through the Baron Sewer. We'll come across this Kainatsu that we saw at the very beginning of the game, but then we'll see who's on the throne. I wonder if Bygon will have traded places with Kainatsu.
It's just a really weird coup.
I mean, it's just opposite day. You have to abide by opposite day.
Oh.
Now, Scratch Dragon has both an Ice Claw and a Thunder Claw on his Yang, I believe. If not, he at least has them in the inventory, which is great for this Kainatsu, because when Kainatsu has the water up, he's weak to lightning. When he has the water down, he's weak to ice. So Yang will be able to hit the weakness the entire time, and that's why we just see him get berserk.
But if it's opposite day, then wouldn't he be weak to ice with the water up, or am I overthinking this?
Either way, he still has both claws, so we're good.
Okay. Well.
Papita asking, both players have Tella, why go for Mac Giant? At this point, you don't. But it was just an observation about the shop.
seeing double here. 4K Natsos.
You need to get your eyes checked, Dijon. There's only 2K Natsos on the screen. That lit to hit for over 1,000. Very nice palindromic 1,001 damage. Oh, Kanatsu's just trying to say hi.
Do the wave.
And despite getting to this fight second, profcory has gotten Kanatsu in the shell and gotten through the fight before Scratchdragon. Dropping that battle speed just in case there's a cheeky wyvern here. I know that feeling all too well when you get through a boss and you go, I'm fine. And then you get punished for your hubris.
There is a lunar sparkle.
Oh, Prof Corey, did you read the seed? It's just a pale dome. Probably the easiest of lunar sparkles. Plague can be easier, but it depends.
It depends on where it is and how much health it has.
Yeah, Pale Dim is very straightforward, not too hard.
Babby's first moon boss.
Yeah, which makes sense because Pale Dim is the first moon boss you will find unless you decide to peek Cave Bahamut, but that's a whole different designation.
It's pronounced Cave of Value.
The Bahamut is silent. Don't summon against Pale Dim, Scratch Dragon. That's not going to end well.
Quack.
Yeah, don't do that. Yeah, don't summon against Pale Dim. He counters with Quake.
Yikes.
That hurt.
Yeah, now he's got to go all the way back through the sewer and fight Kanatsu again. So that's that is a big time loss for Scratch Dragon.
Yeah. That is a... Hey, look, another Tella.
Hey.
That is an interaction that you don't really know about until you get punished by it. So it's very possible Scratch either didn't know or in the heat of the race just completely it left his mind. It's understandable mistake, though.
It's the Elsa Tella. But Prof Corey already has a Tella, so he has to let it go.
I mean, he could just go the with the stupid sexy Flanders strats of going into Threemus with 3 Tellas in the same party.
Gosh. Ask well, he me can't how do that now. He's only got one slot.
Well, that's fair. Ask me how that went for stupid sexy Flanders.
I'm going to say not great.
He won that race.
Oh, well, then. Charm.
Hey, Charm. It's good.
It's a good weapon.
Second best black magic staff.
But it's not a Luka Key or a Legend Sword, so...
We're now heading to Dwarf, maybe looking for another taste of vanilla here. Hoping to maybe find a Luka Key. If you have not tuned in since the group flags ended, we no longer have the warp glitch enabled. So this is just one key item check in group. Dwarf is pretty heavily valued as long as you had a warp caster because you could get a 2-for-1. No longer the case.
Yes, the warp glitch is indeed turned off. You have to work for your Luka sealed cave item. Hey, it's Azura.
By the way, Dijon, you nailed it. Got it. Luka sealed cave item. Got it.
Yes.
Ysera here. Interesting. So We have two great axes. Neither of them are a rune axe. We have a mute knife, but we don't have anybody to use it.
Got star veils.
Yeah, got a couple star veils. Go ahead and... Pop one on a character, pop another on the same character, get Wall onto the Sasira so that she will cast on herself. It appears we do have some mute arrows, though. What bow do we have to go with? Oh, did he sell his bow?
I think one of the characters has the bow equipped.
Judging by him parrying on the second Sid, I think he may have sold his last bow. Oh, or just hard cast Wall. This will last less time, but
serves
the same purpose.
Yeah, if you can't cast homemade wall, then store bought is fine. One of the fun little quirks of the battle engine is if you are already walled and you use a star veil on yourself, it'll bounce that star veil off onto the opponent.
Yep, because fortunately, star veils just count as a self-casted wall, so it still counts as a casted spell. This spot is pretty punchy, though. As we see, Asira punched the front row Sid, and he's now grinning on the floor. This, we might need to get some blinks up here. There we go.
Approximately, 182 of them.
So... Interesting mirror here. We have profcory fighting Asira on the left side, and Scratchdragon just casted Asira on the right side. I don't know what's worse, the fact that the Sids have a difference of magic in their max HP of 1, or the fact that neither of them have broken 1,000 hit points yet.
I guess is equipment.
No, that's just random. Your stats are set when you level up within a certain range, or at least your HP is. Your stats are pretty much set, especially your agility. That's consistent. But your HP increases within like a range, so two characters can be the same level with slightly different hit point values.
So different HP IVs, got it.
Okay, yeah, we'll go with that. Looks like the wall did wear off. That is one reason why Star Veils are much preferred in that particular fight. But the damage output and the damage input was not a great trade-off either. Profcory gonna try it again, though. We'll see if second attempt goes a bit better.
Second verse, same as the first.
Chat pointing out you can use that moon veil and Asira can never kill you. That is true. This is a fight where I'm not necessarily on board with the moon veil being a worthy enough spot to use the moon veil. Yes, it'll get you through this. But you might need it a bit later. Whereas if you, hey, here we go, Tella. If you can Meteo here, you're fine. This will do quad nines, almost definitely. Tella's wisdom is kind of crappy, but I think he has a, like a Lilith rod on. So. Surprised he didn't throw, no need to throw out a blink if you're not attacking, but you're attacking. All right, I'm officially confused.
It's fine. Don't worry about it.
No, don't say it. I knew it was coming. Meanwhile, back in Baron Castle, Scratchdragon is finally going to show us who's at the element or the levee spot, because we found, was it Leg? Let me show you how. Which means Elevance is at levee. That's actually pretty good news. That spot's pretty punchy, but because Elements is broken up into two phases, quote unquote, you can just reflect fire threes off of one of your characters onto the Mylon Z form and get over with it pretty quickly. Also, I'm going to correct myself and say Mylon Z before anybody comes at me, because I always correct people for saying Mylon Z.
What, are you Canadian?
No, but Mylon Z is, so. He is the Canadian Scarmelignon.
The Canadian what now?
Scarmelignon. It's okay, you can just say bless you.
Gesundheit.
Meanwhile...
The Z stands for Zux.
Vanilla! Vanilla Gomez! And another Tala!
Wow! Okay. It could be triple Tala.
Was it vanilla? Let me show you how. So we've got some delicious vanilla over here. This is actually great. This is a vanilla boss that you love to see. This spot is meant to be a story battle that doesn't hit very hard with its spells. So assuming both these Sids survive, you're in a great position. If at least one survives, you're not going to have that bad of a time. But Scratchdragon is giving the people what they want, and we are about to get some music, courtesy of DJ Spoony B. Chat's gonna hate me, but I do want to chime in here while we're in this Valvalis fight. The lovely music today was the FF2 Tower of Magi. Scratchdragon doing the good work and actually showing us that, so chat can confirm their suspicions. But if you're gonna see Valvalis, this is the spot to see her. This spot already has 254 magic defense, so her tornado form doesn't really make too much difference here. It's going to be hard to get through it with physical attacks, but with Berserk and just enough healing, this is pretty safe. Tornado form does not add magic defense. It sets her magic defense to a particular value depending on the spot. In some spots, that value is 255, which makes her completely immune to all magic while in tornado form. It is a bad time.
Speaking of a bad time, Prof. Corey's reward was a ninja sword.
Yeah, not what you were looking for. There is no ninja to be seen yet this seed, but that is a cool 33,000 GP if he decides to sell it rather than waiting maybe to find an edge if he gets another character unlocking Adam.
So, unless I'm missing something, it's looking like, depending on what this Valvalis had,
power key. That's pretty interesting.
So that means it's either one of the tower checks or one of the Feymarch bosses, unless I'm forgetting something.
No, it could still be that demist at Maga Sisters. Fingers crossed. Profcory, though, opting to go straight to Harp as well. This is pretty good. I would have been tempted to do Keyless Tower here, but then upon doing music, being given the tower key would have been a little bit of an oof. So getting a music reprise here shortly, while Scratchdragon goes around and checks a few more shops that he has yet to check before heading back underground. And I imagine beelining straight for that tower key and keyed tower combo, I suppose.
Yeah, you do like your keyless tower.
I am heavily biased towards keyless tower, and if anyone watched my race versus Zelch, they will know why.
Yep.
That comment is actually good enough time as any to plug the YouTube playlist. If you're watching this as a VOD or you're watching it live and want to go back and watch some fantastic races, we have a playlist on our YouTube channel. It's just the Free Enterprise channel on YouTube that holds all of our restreamed matches. We have passed over 200 restreamed races for this tournament. To put that into perspective, there have been over 360 races total. We have restreamed more than half of them.
And if you like hearing our voices, well then good news, we've both commentated a bunch of those races. Also, Job Dwarf is a cardiologist. And Scratchdragon has validated the seed.
Yeah, Scratchdragon validating the seed. Disclaimer, Job Dwarf not actually required to validate a seed. But doing basically triple people's champion here, checking Job Dwarf, checking the harp, and also checking what the song was, just in case people didn't know. And while we get a reprise of DJ Spoonie B's music, this time I will stay quiet. And profcory is through the Valvalis there and will be rewarded with his tower key, and I imagine he makes a complete 180 and goes right back underground to chase this, because at this point in the seed, neither of those Feymarch bosses is looking particularly appealing.
I imagine he's not looking forward to fighting either of those bosses.
Yeah, the elements at levy is pretty okay if you have a pretty mage heavy party. At this point, we basically only have Rydia and Tella as far as offensive magic, and Rydia doesn't have fire 3. Tella's fire 3 is Tella, In that Octomam is very speedy, the Asura spot being one of the fastest in the game. And that's not what you want to see for a boss that is basically already really speedy. Fortunately, you can slow it down, but yeah, tower sounds a lot better right now.
Yep, there's that tower.
Profcory has done Dwarf. That is where Scratchdragon currently is. These runners have effectively done the exact same checks with only minimal divergence. Once Scratchdragon is done here, I imagine he'll be following Profcory here into tower. The main difference between this race is that Profcory took a second Cid early, and that extra early melee damage has kind of carried him through with an Ogrex and a Poison Axe. It'll be interesting to see if, as we mentioned earlier, if we can get go mode before Darkness Crystal, what our runners decide to do for a grind, or if they just try and hunt out that Darkness Crystal, because it does have to be somewhere. It cannot be locked behind itself.
There's one Wylon saying water hag.
And yeah, there goes our water hag out of the pool. That means that water hag is at the Ribicante spot in Upper Babel. We will not be seeing that spot. So if you were hoping to maybe find a water hag on the moon, sorry about that. But which flavor of Mylan are we getting here? Is it going to be N Friends or Zed?
Zed's dead, baby.
There we go, the Canadian Skrmalion himself. This isn't too bad. A little punchy, but overall not horrible. It does have the HP of effectively both parts of the Lugia fight combined, but that middle Cid doing 1k a swing. We can just keep people alive, maybe get some blinks up. Mylan Zed only punches. Shouldn't be too awful.
Petition to replace Mylon Z with Coach Z.
Petition denied.
Oh, crackles.
Dijon, no. oh my.
The runners are doing a great job.
I don't know if I could make me getting out of my chair audible enough for my mic to pick up, but I was about to just get up and walk away. This might get out of hand for Profcory here. He's got his two Cids berserked. If this Mylon takes out his Porum, he'll be left basically just put down the controller and hope.
Yeah, Porum's trying real hard to keep that party alive. And now she's down, but she did get Tella back up.
Yep, this feels like it's just going to be Tella and Porum trading life potions. But actually, we had
trying
a spell
to run
queued
buffer.
Up. Yeah, queued up a spell with Tella, run buffering to try and get that to go off potentially before Mylon can. Yep, there's the board face AI. All right, put down the controller, Profcory.
Wow, I can't believe they put an auto battle function in.
Fortunately, we did get through it here. Just a spoon. So if you wanted to have some soup, that would be good. Otherwise,
hey, haven't done a grind yet, so that's one closer to 10 KI.
Yep, that's basically its only use at this point. That puts Profcory at 2, 4, 6, 7 key items. He has 3 locations left to check. Also, there is the Baron basement where we saw the Rubicante earlier. So,
oh, yeah.
So we have a Maga Sisters here at the Super Cannon. That's not too bad. We have a Elements at Leviathan, an Octomammoth at Asura, and a Rubicant at the Odin spot. Those last three things I listed, not particularly fun if you don't have a way to grind beforehand.
Also, I love how perfectly, like, the spot with the three cannon parts are operated by the three sisters. You would almost think it was vanilla.
Almost, but not quite.
It's not. That's where the dark elves go.
That's where the dark imps go.
Dark imps. I keep mixing up imp and elf.
I mean, I would say a common mistake, but I feel like the elves and imps in the audience would be offended by that, so. But yeah, that spot's showing that it has very little HP because it is meant to just be three dark imps with absolutely no HP, and that carries over. So profcory will be exiting lower Babel. We'll get a high five here, and there it was in the doorway. And profcory will get this key item and learn whether or not he has to go do one of those bosses he probably doesn't want to do.
Woo. We're hoping for a Legend Sword or a Luka Key.
Yep. As a viewer and commentator, I'm hoping for a Luka Key, a Legend Sword, or a Womp, because I don't want them to have access to their grind via Darkness Crystal. And if they don't get Go Mode here, I want them to have to go through one of those bosses, because I want to see some well-executed strategies on some of those bosses with this party and its current power level.
Oh, Darkness Crystal.
Womp womp. Okay. That's a womp womp for the viewers. This Darkness Crystal now opens up all, what is it? 7 checks on the moon, as well as gives us our grind. We have a Tella. We just need life potions and ethers, and we can get all the levels that we may need.
Wait, there's 7 on the moon? I thought it was 6.
It's the room is 2, so.
Okay, that's where the confusion was. I was thinking bosses.
Yeah, I was being tricksy there. I was counting key items. Ether 2's here in Tamra. Rockquarry picks up some, so looks like he is going to go straight to his Demon Machine grind. It'll be interesting to see if he grabs the Yang, maybe, or if he grabs Iridia. The Yang would set him up for a pretty heavy physical party. He has Tele, yes, Porum would be good for berserking. Rydia would give him an option for nuke. Either option will be within the range of slingshot.
Could also check the moon slot.
Very true. We did get that ninja sword. If you wanted to maybe check and see if there's an edge there, you could go and steal Bacchus wines. You can't steal sirens, can steal Bacchus wines. But getting an edge would turn off your slingshot because your lowest two characters are level 23, edge comes in at 25, and you need at least a 5 level difference between your median character and anyone you want to slingshot.
A Palum could also be a good find up there.
Also true. Looks like he's going to set up his Manip before going to the Tower of Wishes to retrieve his 5th character. I sincerely hope he remembers to go get his 5th character. One, because you don't want to just grind with 4 characters, but 2, you don't have the opportunity to get a slingshot unless you have a full party. Scratchdragon, meanwhile, at the top of Lower Babel, taking down Mylon Zed, showing that profcory has opened up a relatively decent lead here by at least a couple minutes. That is primarily due to that wipe that Scratchdragon took back in Baron Castle when he cast Chocobo on the Paladin and got counterquaked, and then only was left with the Sid alive, who was promptly punched down onto the floor. That cost him a couple minutes, and that's the difference in the race right now.
I love this frame rate just makes all the all the characters look blurry.
Yep. It wasn't... So I've been playing Free Enterprise for at least 7 months, and it wasn't until the other day that I realized that when you blink, you actually are given a visual indicator of how many stacks of it are left. It creates two images on the character, and then every time you're hit, one of those images disappears. It was a fun thing that I was just completely unobservant about. I'm not alone, apparently.
Here comes the whale.
Yep.
A long but necessary cutscene.
Not always necessary. We have a path. Like, they could have gone to do one of those other three bosses and gotten go mode. They didn't have the big
long
whale.
And necessary. Besides, you still gotta grind.
Just get your Luka key and go to a door grind. It's fine. You don't need no darkness crystal.
Oh, gonna go with Rydia.
Go with Rydia and get that slingshot up to Nuke. This makes sense. Probably gonna be going with a hybrid strat here. With two SIDs, that's not super great, like end game damage for Zoromus. So honestly, if Scratchdragon like gets this darkness crystal and then goes to grind immediately, even without getting a slingshot on his characters, his Yang is going to be doing probably about as much damage as both of profcory SIDs combined after being leveled. That could end up being a difference in this race, this party comp difference. For those unaware, there's basically four different Z fight strategies. That's a tongue twister that shouldn't be. one of which being reflex strats. That's typically what you'll see where you throw up a wall on a character, reflect nukes and whites to avoid the refill script, do 61,000 damage, collect your victory. Berserk strats, you berserk up a bunch of physical characters, you don't care about the they refill. You just power overwhelming him, trying to kill him before the second big bang. There are what we call 1200 HP strats, or looks like they're trying to coin a new name in Discord, ZMS strats, Zilch Mecha Simbu, kind of the pioneers of that strategy. And that is where you don't even care about grinding. You go in with a character that has at least 1200 HP, stack of vampires and stack of star veils, and do effectively Eddy strats. So I'm gonna roll those together. And then hybrid strats, that's where you kind of do a little of berserking and a little bit of reflecting, and you just eat through the HP as best you can.
Scratchdragon making his way out of the tower, gonna get that darkness crystal.
Yep, and profcory making good use of that darkness crystal. Did the manipulation outside of Baron to get the encounter table where he wanted it, so that the next encounter he found in the Giant of Babel would be this particular fight, a searcher, two beamers, and this particular searcher, when hit, will summon a D-machine. D-machines are a fantastic enemy for grinding, for multiple reasons. Unless they are physically attacked, they only attack with fire. That is an HP-based damage. HP-based attack, so you don't need levels to survive it. It just does a percentage of your max HP. Beamers do the same thing, and they are susceptible to the weak spell, which will bring them down to single-digit HP, which you can then just hit them with basically any physical attack to kill them. And with the life glitch enabled, as we have it, you can use a life on an enemy that has died. You have to queue it up before it completely dies. You'll see that demonstrated shortly, which will then revive the enemy. And revivals in FF4 are based off of the vitality stat. It's a multiplier based off of your vitality stat. And with all enemies in the game having zero vitality, they come back with zero HP, instantly die, but you get the experience, GP, and item drop chance as if you had killed a full nether one. So this Rydia, in order to get Rydia to nuke, you need about a million experience points. That calculates out to about 24 D machines, so 12 plus 12 life glitches. But with a slingshot on her, we'll need 6 plus 6 life glitches. If we had 10 key items, it would be 3 plus 3. It'd be very quick. But we might see a little bit bigger of a grind than that to try and get this Porum to white. If we don't want to go all the way to white, definitely to cure 4. And to get these Cids a bit more strength to make them a bit more viable for Zoromus.
Also, if you look closely at the D-Machine's sprite, you'll notice that its head is facing backwards with its mouth wide open and air coming out, meaning that the D-Machine scram at own butt.
I was not sure where you were going with that, and that was not what I expected. Oh no. I thought you were going to talk about how the fire isn't going into the right direction, and I was all ready to talk about how it had like fire launchers in its shoulders. I was ready. I was ready for everything except that. Aether2's here getting Tella back all of his MP. The Soma drop we found earlier, as I mentioned, gives Tella 100 MP. Weak costs 25, so with one single Soma drop, it allows him to cast 4 weeks per HP pool rather than just 3 and having 15 left over. Makes for a much more efficient and easier to count grind overall. And Scratchdragon, talking to the man aboard the big whale, will be going to the giant of Babel himself to initiate his D-Machine grind. So we're going to have dueling grinds going. What happens after that is probably going to be what decides this race. If Scratchdragon can diverge just a bit from profcory and find either the Legend Sword or the Luka Key, he will pull ahead. If profcory comes out and Scratchdragon continues to follow in his footsteps, checking every check he's checked. He might make up some ground, but we'll have to see if that'll be enough.
I don't know what I missed, but chat is talking about Bob Newhart.
I've just completely checked out of chat right now. I think we sent them down some sort of rabbit hole. It's almost like we gave them like an earth crystal into a rat tail into a tower key. Like they're down a deep rabbit hole right now. Oh, we have mirrored grinds. This is nice.
Oh yeah, because Prof Corey got back attacked.
Yep. Now, the one thing you don't want to do on the D-Machine here is to accidentally hit it before you've weaked it, because at that point, it will counterattack with a very punchy physical attack.
Yeah, sometimes the, the agility and turn order gets a little wonky when it's been going a while, and you'll, like, cue them up, but then, like, the attack will happen before the week, and it's a whole thing.
Yep, and that's another primary reason that we put Tella in the middle slot on this grind, because Tella has a penchant for missing his spells. And you don't want that to happen if you can avoid it. So making sure that weak can hit, because the middle slot grants 25% accuracy bonus. The worst thing to happen is for you to queue up the attack, have the weak miss, and then the demon machine just punches your Tella and you just can't recover. Feels bad.
Also, these searchers must be rich because they have two beamers.
Really?
What else are you gonna talk about in dual grind?
Oh no. Combo plays.
Tell us weaking another one.
If it's dual grinds, we can just talk about like synchro summons, exceed summons, link summon.
Is that a Yu-Gi-Oh thing?
That's absolutely a Yu-Gi-Oh thing.
Okay.
I'm partially curious how many people watching I just alienated, and how many people that just watching that I made Pog. Very curious.
Sweetie, if we hadn't alienated them before that.
Okay, one person is on board talking about how Duel Links has exceed summons now. Yes. You're my favorite person in chat.
I mean, it's not like you've ever spent 20 hours playing the entire game.
I try to forget I did that. But speedrun.com won't let me forget.
Well, its days are numbered now.
Anyway.
Anyway.
Right, Scala.
Spoiler alert, I'm Zoe's favorite.
Shh. Don't dash their hopes. I guess I can take this opportunity to shout out our wonderful restreamer and tracker behind the scenes. We've got Nyobari, who rolled this seed and is restreaming, bringing our silliness to you for better or worse. Maggie the cat, lighting up all the buttons, doing their best not to be distracted by our silliness, I imagine. And then across from me in the booth is lovely Dijon Ketchup, someone who I enjoy spending time with any chance I can. And then there's me, ZoeVermilion, but you knew that by now, so.
Zoe is a good.
Oh, thank you. And also follow our runners. Both these runners are great players. If you enjoy free enterprise content, you'll enjoy their channels as well as anything else they might play. At this point, I think most people in this tournament haven't played anything else since August, so. Oh, well, except for Among Us, maybe. I have sent chat down a completely different rabbit hole now. They're just talking about Yu-Gi-Oh! And making Yu-Gi-Oh! Jokes. I love it.
It's time to D-Machine grind.
You're much better at that than I am. I always get tongue twisted somehow, just trying to do the da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
It's because my favorite band is Bare Naked Ladies.
I never would have guessed.
Also, hey, profcory finished and has a lot of experience.
Yep, that was enough to get white and life 2 onto Porum. That's a pretty high level. This Ridia is easily going to get nuke. Took down the Tella, so Tella's going to be serving as the agility anchor here. Both these Sids are going to have a pretty massive HP pool. And their strength is not going to be any slouch either. They won't be doing the damage you'd expect out of, like, a Kane or a Cecil. But it'll be respectable in its own right.
And profcory managed to defeat the real final boss, remembering to turn encounters off.
Yes, don't forget that. That is how you really... really make yourself feel bad is forgetting to turn it off, running into an encounter that you can no longer run from, and everyone is not at their max HP or MP after having just done a D machine grind, and you take a wipe, and you have to do it all over again.
So now, the question. We've got Baron Basement. We've got Feymarch bosses. We've got Moon. Where is profcory gonna go?
So, my thought here is go full clear the moon. You have a pass, so if you find go mode up there, you can just come down, turn it in, and go. If we didn't have a pass, I would potentially say do like Baron and Feymarch to clear up the blue planet first, but profcory seems to agree with me. Touching the crystal, go into the moon. Let's see who could have been. Or not. Let's do Value Cave first. Good job.
Yeah. Value Cave.
There's always value in Cave Bahamut.
Is there, though?
Even when there's not value, the value was the boss that we killed along the way.
The value's in your mind.
I don't know why Scratchdragon even has a Porum in the party at this point. Rydia seems to be the better white mage with Asura, like...
It's got white.
PK is trying to get us to chant something, but I refuse, PK. You can say it for the next time you and me do comms together.
PK, our good friend Ponky Kong.
No, it's Funderclaw. P-H-U-N-D-E-R. K-L-A-W.
That sounds like a bad G.I. Joe villain.
PK, are you a bad G.I. Joe villain?
Alright. Well, that's a mom bomb.
That is a mom bomb. This is a very punchy spot. Mom bomb... basically only punches aside from the explosion. We're gonna be getting up some berserks, getting up some blinks. That's sitting in the back row, taking 1300 damage.
Yeesh.
This Rydia in the front row will probably be one shot.
She's at least getting a nuke.
Yeah, not to mention that Mom Bomb has about 9,000 extra HP. Just to account for her battle script, if you want to kill her before she splits into the small bombs.
Well, profcory blinked the Rydia, so maybe she'll survive a bit longer.
Yeah, ooh, Orm either goes down.
Porum's hiding in the corner, though.
There comes the blink onto the Porum. Also, for anyone wondering, the only answer I got from PK was G.I. Joe with four E's, and it was all capital letters. So I think PK might be a bad G.I. Joe villain. Just so we don't leave that we don't want to leave a plot hole in this restream.
Hey kid, I'm a computer. Stop all the downloading. Help computer.
Maggie did this, just so everyone knows. Okay, profcory gets through mom bomb, got through the extra HP, found a power shirt. Not the key item you're looking for. You'll take it.
Pretty good piece of gear, though.
Yep.
Not resetting out. That's going immediately on a Cid.
Yeah. Maggie, I was saying that you're the one that put me and Dijon together, so you did this.
Chat. I beat Cave Value and all I got was this t-shirt.
Oh, that's real good. I told you the value was the boss that we fought along the way.
I mean, there was value, it's just not as value as you would have hoped. It's not my fault that you set your expectations that high.
Now I have to wonder if profcory is going to go top down here or make the standard play down to Ribbon Room because it's more dense with key items.
Yeah, Ribbon Room is a popular choice for the first place to go.
I have seen top down be what would have been the right play in many seeds so far, so I'm rooting for top down here.
Well, somebody flew Yang to the moon so he could kick its heckin' butt.
Yep. Gonna get a save here. This might be a top-down play. This save to set up a save scum in case you don't get what you want from the Murasame altar.
So would you say that we're getting a top-down perspective?
I walked into that one. Hold on. There we go. I am actually really happy to see this.
And Scratchdragon finally done with his grind.
Gets over a million before any sort of slingshot, which he didn't have available to him, unfortunately. Also, his Rydia and Della have the exact same hit point, both current and maximum right now. That's kind of weird.
Didn't knock out the Telefer, so he's gonna get all that experience as well.
Yeah, if he has that cursed ring, it's not really that bad. Tella, even worst case scenario, with a cursed ring, caps out at like 8 or 9 agility. So.
Okay, profcory attacked the Mylon before the gas, so that always makes me nervous.
Yeah, you don't want to do that. Fortunately, the spot has enough HP where it won't punish you, but killing Mylon before those gas makes those gas incredibly punchy, and they can one-shot your party at a lot of locations.
Yeah, they get pretty berserk.
Yeah. All right, Scratchdragon, what's your play going to be? Appears to be going and getting the Enterprise, so opting to not go straight to the moon. So this is the divergence that might pull him back into this race.
Okay, and that's a Mylon down.
And
just a tail.
There's the reset, save scummed it. Just as one of these commentators predicted, it's almost like I sometimes know what's going on, even if I can't do it myself.
Yeah, I'm pretty good at commentating on things, but not particularly great at actually playing the game.
Well, we have the zero stress environment to observe things in, so. Profcory going back in should be, I imagine, diving all the way down to the Ribbon Room. If he was going to do Wyvern Altar first, I imagine that he might have come back in or kind of backtracked. I'm not sure. That Wyvern Altar is in such an annoying location that routing it in either top down or bottom up is obnoxious.
And Scratch Dragon's going to fight the leg that's hidden in the basement.
Yep. Should still have that Ice Claw on Yang. That's going to be putting in some good work here. Decides just to go and berserk up that Yang. Do not blame. Fire 2s here won't hit the worst. And this Yang will be hitting for a pretty high amount of damage. As will that Glare.
Ooh. Yeah, that poor arm didn't stand a chance.
Nope. Yeah, 8k coming in from the Yang. One more swing, I think, is enough to take down this spot.
Oh, well, that's the nope rope.
Yeah, so this favors the physical party. So, Ogopogo at Ribbon Room. This is interesting. Has 42,000 hit points. Very punchy boss. You don't want to hit it with black magic or summons. Ooh. That's interesting. So that was a pan, which will lead us to two more key items. without having to do another boss. It'll be very interesting if one of those turns into go mode. Let's see what this pan turns into and whether or not this is going to have been a really big brain play to do the Odin spot first.
Indeed. This is turning one key item into two.
Yep. See what we get from the sylphs after Yang bonks himself on the head with the pan and then goes back to his wife to turn in the pan. And gets another key item. There's
hey!
Go mode. So, profcory had a decent lead after Scratchdragon's faux pas with the Pale Dim in Baron Castle, but Scratchdragon opting to not go to the moon probably felt a little behind, didn't want to leave go mode on the blue planet. Does the Baron Odin throne right away and gets a pan, which goes into a Luka key, which all he has to do is open this door. He doesn't have to clear it. He's going to get his crystal.
Wow, I can't believe the Fae stole Luka's name.
And profcory got through the Ogopogo without much issue and got an Earth crystal and a Lunar staff. So at this point, I think the script has flipped back into the favor of Scratchdragon. Profcory needs a quick legend sword and maybe a wipe from Scratchdragon to get back in this.
There's D-Lunars.
D-Lunars moved next door. They didn't like their quarters, so they decided to take plagues instead.
Yeah, all the moon bosses kind of played round robin, it looks
yep.
like.
Ogopogo moved up to Ribbon Room, D-Lunars moved over here to Plague. Plague probably moved over to the Wyvern Altar, and I bet you Wyvern's down at Ogopogo.
Meanwhile, Mylon and friends are just hanging out.
Yeah, because Paladin's kind of like the black sheep. He never really fit in with the rest of the family, and so he went off to college in Baron. Started a really successful career, became a politician, and eventually became king. So he doesn't really talk to his family much anymore.
But that pass we started off with really coming in handy here.
Yep. Yeah, so we're getting some flags here in chat, and it's okay. I know I've been a great commentator tonight. You don't have to cheer me on with the Zoe flags. It's okay.
Prof Corey got a Stardust rod, which is a good rod. Don't get me wrong.
Yeah. You know, Dijon, I don't think they're actually cheering for me. I think they want us to ask a question.
Yeah, I was going to say that, but I didn't want to, like, hurt your feelings.
It's okay. I'm a big girl. I can take it.
Okay. Well, do you want to ask the question?
I'm too embarrassed at this point.
Okay, well, whose butt are we gonna kick tonight?
Everyone asks whose butt. No one ever asks how his butt. Butt could use a hug, not a kick.
Well, too bad. There's no hug option.
Scala, make it happen.
That sounds like more of a board thing, honestly.
What? Board isn't here. Ah, there's not. There. It is an option.
Oh.
Excellent. So we just need to 64 glitch and get Hug into our spell list so we can hug Zoromus, right?
Prof Corey facing the Calbrenna dolls. And meanwhile, Can we show that on this channel?
I have a DM to send Scala, hold on. Okay, DM sent. We have Genovimus.
Profcory getting some samurai armor from the Calbrenna dolls and resetting out of that.
Yep, Dolls of Ogopogo is not necessarily fun if you don't have a ready source of multiple quakes. Medio could have done it, but trying to get a blink up on Tella to survive it, maybe not.
Yeah, luckily he did have some quakes, so.
It's gonna go check this Wyvern Altar. Meanwhile, Scratchdragon has a Star Veil up on the Porm, is reflecting some nukes. I believe I saw white reflected as well.
Oh. Now that's the kind of stuff you want to see.
Yeah, Baron Guard.
Still destroyed Tella, though.
And a protect ring. Moon's haunted.
Yeah, moon's haunted. So,
well, it could be behind the earth crystal, I guess.
Yeah. I feel like Prof Corey would probably go fight one of those three bosses before doing earth, though.
Yeah, earth is a significant time investment. Cutscene at the top, couple cutscenes at the top, two bosses, which you're not really scared of at this point, but then also a cutscene afterwards to get out. He is gonna go get his Enterprise. Meanwhile, over on Scratchdragon's side, things appear to be mostly stable. Yeah, Black Hole coming out. Starville coming out after it. We'll be able to get the cure up on everybody, but Sid should be able to resume nuking very shortly.
Oh, Prof Corey going to the Fame Arch. Hopefully. Oh, maybe not. Maybe so.
The Fame Arch hokey pokey. Yeah, opting here. Instead of the Odin Throne, going to probably, I imagine, take the Elements fight first, having Fire 3 on Rydia, Nuke for that matter. Fire 3 will hit for Quad 9s, but it takes longer to cast. Just some Reflects, shouldn't take too long. Octomam, if you can get some Blinks up and then get a few of the tentacles down, because she loses like one tentacle every hit, shouldn't be too bad.
Well, hopefully for Prof Corey's sake, one of those bosses has the Legend Sword.
Yep, Scratchdragon is most of the way through his Aromas fight here. So, hopefully, for his sake, hopefully he doesn't take a wipe. For Prof Corey's sake, hopefully he takes a wipe. That was a pretty decent Big Bang roll.
Actually going Octomam first.
Very interesting. This is a fight that would benefit from having that Yang and a Thunderclaw. Having Nuke, this spot should go down relatively quick. And as long as you can get some blinks up, you could be fine.
Octoman. Nobody suspects a thing. Oh, yeah. That's a GG on Scratchdragon.
Is a finish. Scratchdragon is our winner of this race. We'll move to 2 and 3 with an official Discord race bot time of 1 hour, 42 minutes, and 45 seconds. And I think we have been joined by both of our racers, because as soon as this finish came in, profcory did forfeit. So GG's to both of you.
GG's. Help, I've been kidnapped. We were up there talking to General. Help.
GG.
Now you're stuck with us.
What's going on, guys? What a seed, right?
Yeah.
It was definitely pretty interesting. Don't rewatch the VOD, because I definitely was not rooting for you not to find a darkness crystal and wanting to see a more unconventional grind. That's not me at all. Just don't watch the VOD.
It's fine. It's fine.
Trust me.
No,
trust me.
It's fine. I don't want to watch the VOD anyway. I made the... You know when you move two abilities around and you accidentally use one and it ends you, you use a summon against Pale Dim?
Is that what happened with the Chocobo? You were trying to use a Syrah?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I was curious. I was like, what happened there?
Like, why Chocobo of all summons?
That was not what it was supposed to be.
That makes more sense now. But yeah, GG's to both of you. Scratchdragon, you're at 2 and 3. 3 and 3 still has an outside chance of making it in, depending on how the cards fall and strength of schedules. Prof Corey, I'm sure you know, unfortunately, four losses is effectively mathematically eliminated. But you've been doing wonderful this tournament and wanted to extend a huge GG for that.
Appreciate it. Yeah, I'm sad, but that's how it goes. I'm very glad that I made it as far as I have. I'm very happy with how much better I am at the game than when I started this tournament. So I'm looking forward to carrying that into free enterprise in the future.
Made it one stage further than me, so I'll give you that.
And look on the bright side, you've got one other person whose hopes and dreams you can dash.
I think actually Frost is also eliminated tomorrow, so we're playing for glory.
Yeah, that'll be a pride match, but it'll still be a good one. But yeah, thoughts. I'm real curious. A couple, like, y'all were basically step for step the same route. Scratchdragon fell behind with the slight faux pas on the Pale Dim. And it wasn't until you finished your grinds that we actually saw true divergence, and Scratchdragon just made the money play and found that Luka key from the pan. What are y'all's thoughts on the seed overall?
Very trolly. I 100% thought I was going to have to go to Feymarch to find a darkness crystal or something. I did not know what I was going to do for a grind if I found, like, go mode.
Right there with you. I was terrified that I was going to find go mode without the darkness. And, like, I've practiced 1,200 stats a little bit, but not enough where I felt good about it. But I was going to commit to it if that's what it came down to.
Yeah, I do want to interject here.
Probably about Legend, to say what I was about to say.
The Legend Sword was behind that Luka key.
Yeah.
Oh, was it? Okay.
Yeah, we just caught that on the
spoiler
here. Roll.
So the entire moon, the Feymarch, all haunted, Odin spot was the answer, and that was the place that Scratchdragon went directly to after grinding.
After I checked it the first time and I saw it was Ruby, when I went to go do the grind and, you know, the 6-year grind behind B machines, because, you know, I'm I'm great at D machine grinding, obviously, but I just said to myself, I still have the two ice claws. I'll go kill Ruby real quick. If it's not Ruby, then I'll have to head up to the moon.
Yeah, and your Yang did some work there, over 8k each hit, so it only took like 3 hits to get it done, but that's the way that Rando gonna do sometime. Hard required Rubicant at the Odin spot. You don't see that very often.
Man, that is pretty rough. This will be my one salty thing. I'll stop being a sore loser after that, I promise. I think I've lost an aggravating number of races over my short free enterprise career due to the barren basement. Like, either going or not going when I needed to. It's going to haunt me for a while, I think, that particular location. Yesterday's race came down to that, too. So, I don't know. I don't know what I'm going to do. I guess just get good. I guess that's always the solution, right?
I mean, why do you need to get good when you could just get lucky?
Lucky is a form of good when it comes to free enterprise, it seems. But yeah, this was a ton of fun to commentate. Y'all kept it interesting all the way up until the end. It was real close, and had you taken a wipe there to Zoromist, you know, profcory, you were in Feymarch. You very quickly would have found that Baron basement was the answer, and things could have played out a little bit differently, but. Well played on both sides, regardless.
Thank you, thank you. I was kind of nervous, even though I had 5,000 health on my Yang and Sid.
Things got a bit dicey there. That you had one particularly high big bang that just took out both Horum and Rydia. And I was like, good thing that I zerked.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that got a little scary there.
Yeah. I got super frustrated with some of the Ashura rolls. I was like, why? GG's prof. It was a great race. It wouldn't have been a surprise if I had lost the race here, buddy. You're a great racer. And then just to wrap up anything from my thoughts, shout outs to everyone in the free enterprise communities, the restreamer, the commentators, the trackers. Make sure you guys follow them. Remember to follow Prof Corey and remember to play free enterprise.
Yeah, I like that last piece of advice, especially that free enterprise has been so much fun to get into, just like really sink my teeth into and focus on like how good can I get. Started out, I think El Magus, I think, is the first streamer that I ever saw watching it over a year ago. Took a while before I started to want to like actually try to do the seeds myself, and It's been nothing but fun. I'm rooting for you, Scratch. I haven't looked at like the strength and schedule stuff, but I'm hoping that it works out for you. Much love to the free enterprise community. Everyone's awesome.
Yeah. Shout outs to the crew we had today. Nyobari rolled the seed, did the restream. Maggie the cat behind the scenes was lighting up everything, and me and Dijon were just riffing and having a great time here in the comms booth and occasionally talking about the gameplay. I hope people were able to follow along.
Yeah, it happens sometimes.
But GG's to you both again. For anybody that's still here, don't go anywhere. We are going to be sending you over to the Free Enterprise channel. There's a race in progress. It's getting close to the end. Do not spoil this race. I will bonk you. I can bonk you over there. I can bonk you here. We will find you, and we will give you a stern talking to. But really, don't take it too seriously. People like to watch the VODs, so just don't spoil the races. But for now, I've been ZoeVermilion.
And I am dijonketchup.
And we both hope you have a wonderful rest of your evening. Goodbye, everybody.